So with our candidates for village council, again, they will each have 5 minutes to introduce themselves and give you a little bit of background as to who they are and why they would like to be a member of village council, what they bring to the table. And in addition, they each have 2 questions that they have been asked prior to the candidates' night that they had thought about, and they will answer that within their 5 minute allotted time. The 2 questions, just to reiterate, number one, The first question, in your opinion, what are the 2 most important issues a newly elected village council should address while in office? And what ideas do you have to address these issues, to address the issues that you have stated? So we're going to start out in alphabetical order, and if you can just introduce yourself and then go into your 5 minutes. When you have less than 3 minutes left, you'll see a sign so you can kind of peek back over here. Then after that, the cowbell. So let's go ahead and start with Miss Chrissy Cruz.
Hi, I'm Chrissy Cruz. I've lived in Yellow Springs for most of my life. I raised 2 of my children here, and now my teenage grandson, who I've raised since gaining custody when he was 2 years old. I've served on the Human Relations Commission for 3 years now, first as treasurer, and currently as the vice chair. I prioritize attending every possible meeting. I also show up prepared, having gone over the meeting packet thoroughly and researching the issues being brought to the table for discussion and action. And as a council member, I would feel that was a priority as well. I take on projects gladly and have been in charge of the neighborhood block parties and various other community building projects. I am active in the community in many areas. For the last several years, I have been involved in collecting donations of school supplies and Christmas gifts for children in need. I also help people with their utility bills to avoid getting shut off with a program I created called the $10 Club. I have also used this program to help others in need, for instance, donating gas money to a couple who had been out of work but finally found new jobs and needed gas money to get back and forth to work before receiving their first paychecks. And after a few weeks of being paid, they repaid that money, and it got passed on to another needy family. I regularly attend village council meetings because I believe it's important to keep up with the discussions and decisions being made by the folks sitting at the council table. I frequently speak up in meetings because it is important that citizens speak up about the issues that they care about and that their concerns are addressed by the members of council. Giving our representatives input and feedback is vital to helping them make decisions that are in line with community values and interests. For instance, when the plans for the downtown streetscape first came out with the new sidewalks, I pointed out at a village council meeting that we also should be taking a look at the sidewalks around our elementary school, that some of them were in such bad shape that I had seen handicapped children getting stuck in their wheelchairs just trying to get into school. And the interim village manager at the time, Kent Bristol, went out the next day and looked around, and he agreed with me. And a few weeks later, there was legislation to replace the bad sidewalks. These people, just because they are representing us and they're prominent, that doesn't mean they're omnipotent. They don't know everything that's going on in the village. You've got to tell them, talk to them, and hold them accountable, too. One of the issues that council really needs to address is housing, especially rental properties and apartments. Many of the people who work here cannot afford to live here, and many seniors who are usually on fixed incomes are impacted as well because it's hard to downsize, due to lack of less pricey properties or lower rent payments. High demand and low supply of housing has created an artificial price inflation. HomeAid does good things for the community, but it can't be the only thing that we rely on to develop and build more affordable housing. I am inspired that council has recently taken on this issue and is addressing it with surveys and a task force to figure out how we can do this work best, and I want to be part of that work. Also, economic development needs to be addressed. Local businesses need to be supported, and one way to do this is to revive the Economic Development Revolving Loan Fund. Our temporary assistant village manager, John Young, produced a brilliant report at his last meeting before he went back to Cincinnati on economic development, and I think a lot of his ideas were really brilliant. He pointed out the importance of the revolving loan fund and also the mistakes that were made in the past and how to make this program better and work for our community. Tourism has been strongly promoted as a way of maintaining our community, and no one can deny that it has been a good source of revenue. I would like to see an intensive business survey done to more clearly quantify its impact. The numbers of visitors have been steadily climbing over the past several years, but how much is it really adding to our economic sustainability? And also, how is it impacting our lives, the folks who live here, and including our community events? I have one more sentence, big sentence. Yellow Springs is fortunate in that so many people living here are engaged in our community, mindful, talented, and creative. Going forward, that is a gift and a blessing, and it affords us the opportunity to figure out new and innovative ways to do things, ways that work better for our community and to address village needs.
Thank you, Kristen.
Good evening. My name is Brian Hausch, and I am currently Vice President of Village Council. I'm just finishing up my fourth year, and I am excited to continue to serve. I think we have a lot of important projects that are in the queue, and I do believe that my being there will add a lot of value to see those getting done. Some of the things that really I think come to light, and I talked about this 4 years ago, is my background as a lawyer. I was an environmental lawyer as well as a public interest lawyer down in New Orleans, as well as a business owner. I think many of you know that I spent 12 years in Thailand running a communications consultancy doing corporate training. And those legal, business, and communications backgrounds have been tremendous in helping to achieve some of the things that I think council has been able to sort of knock off the list, and I want to see those things move forward. Currently, I am the Midwest Policy Manager for Rails to Trails Conservancy, and I think that role and the regional outreach that's involved in that is also very important for Yellow Springs. And I did want to mention that if you picked up my brochure that's in the back table, and feel free to grab one of those locally artist-rendered signs, there's a few of those left. This actually is the brochure that I had 4 years ago. And I printed some extra copies out to make the point that in a lot of ways my platform has not changed. And I think it's really shown the success behind what I often refer to as my style with reach. I'm a rational decision maker, I'm engaged in the community, and I think everyone sees me at most events. I am authentic, I really am a positive guy. I'm optimistic, I'm happy, and I think that's why things get done. And I'm collaborative, and I'm always happy to work with anyone. I know sometimes that we may not see eye to eye and come to the exact conclusion, but I listen very carefully. And so those are things that have not changed. You may also be interested, my three primary issues 4 years ago are things that have been dealt with, and it really kind of articulates my thinking. I will say that next week there will be an insert that highlights what I'm currently thinking about, my 6 commitments to the community. I'm going to talk about a few of those tonight. So, 2 issues, well actually I want to say, for me there are 4 most important issues, and I talk about those in the Yellow Springs News, but tonight I'm not going to talk about village policing in my introduction. I'm not going to talk about the issue around our village manager transition, which is going to be very important over the next 2 years. But what I am going to talk about is affordability and why this is important and how I want to address it with the help of fellow council members and the village. And secondly, maintaining a thriving community. I think these 2 issues are tightly connected. So in terms of affordability, I'm very supportive of some of the short-term ideas that have come up. Mary Ann McQueen brought forward the utility roundup program, which I definitely want to happen as soon as we can implement it. And I think this would be a great thing for our community members who are struggling. The second thing, and actually Chrissy brought it up, is the reviving of the economic, the revolving loan fund. And one of my council liaison positions is with the Economic Sustainability Commission. We've been working very hard, and last Monday we brought a proposal to council, and we're going to move forward with that. I think these are great short-term addresses. But in terms of thinking about long-term, I think there are 3 major components to how we're going to address affordability, and I mean, to be honest, to fight gentrification. I think that we want to keep a balanced, diverse community, and those 3 ways are, first of all, sustainable economic development. We want to make sure that we bring in businesses that fit with our village values. Secondly is the housing issue. We need to have a lot of diverse options so that we not only can support affordable housing, but all the other kinds of housing that will bring people to our community and want to live and work here and support that economy that's so important to us. And thirdly, community development. And I was glad to hear the township trustees refer to the issues around internet and the lack of fiber and broadband. This is one of my 6 commitments that I hope to work with the next configuration of council to make that happen, and I'm definitely thinking about the region that surrounds us. That's one of the ways that we can actually make that program more affordable. So if I back up to housing, another commitment of mine is I am totally committed to Glass Farm, and all right, there's my cowbell. And so I will just say, maintaining a thriving community also means community development, broadband, helping our seniors, and also supporting our schools. Thank you. Sorry.
Hi, good evening. I'm Lisa Krieger, and thank you to the James A. Mckee Association for organizing this forum where we can connect and discuss important issues and our ideas to address them. This evening I'll focus on 2 issues, fiscal responsibility and affordability. I see both as levers that will promote an inclusive village that is vibrant with cultural, race, and economic diversity. It's not enough to say all are welcome here and then to passively go on with business as usual. The best Yellow Springs is diverse and adamantly anti-racist. And while we may not be able to compete on market rate housing costs with many surrounding areas, we can demonstrate other attractions of our community. And one critical element is that the village must always use your money for the public good. With that in mind, I will address my ideas about fiscal responsibility. As a nurse executive, I have more than 2 decades of experience working with organizations with very large budgets where people's lives are at stake. And I know that fiscal decisions are more difficult when there's competing priorities. And that's certainly the climate that I would expect to face during my service as a council member. My work on the council is to look closely at the cost of life in the village and to examine how the budget reflects on who we are as a community. I recommend 2 initial strategies to promote fiscal responsibility. My experience is that decision makers monitor the financial health of their organizations by actively participating in committees that oversee operational aspects. The council can adopt a similar approach to more proactively engage in budget making and financial decisions. Additionally, I will evaluate how financial data are presented to council. The financial reporting that comes to council should be presented to highlight trends, changes, and variances. This is the sort of thoughtful, frugal fiscal oversight that promotes effective decision making without creating a climate of analysis paralysis. A second focus that I want to address this evening is affordability. Availability of affordable housing is the single most important factor to attract a diverse population to Yellow Springs. My work on council is to look closely at the cost of life in the village and to determine how our budget and decisions made about village services promote greater affordability. Council must be as frugal as the people living on a fixed income or who must work multiple jobs in order to live here. I don't have all the answers tonight, but commit to take on an innovative stance on what might be possible. Inclusion, fiscal responsibility, and affordability. These are my focus areas, and my campaign slogan is action-oriented. Listen, engage, advance. I will listen to your concerns by maintaining an email address and holding open office hours in the village for conversations. I will continue to remain active in community activities. I will engage by communicating with you about key decisions and will seek to build and strengthen active connections between the council and other key stakeholders, including the school board, Antioch College, the Yellow Springs Community Foundation, the Chamber of Commerce, the 365 Project, Home Inc., and other community organizations. I will advance by applying my experience and knowledge. I've always been an ensemble artist, and that means that I'm most effective working as part of a team, holding my own part, having my own strengths, but able to harmonize with those around me. I've demonstrated that as a musician, as a nurse, working in a pediatric ICU with a medical team, and as the member of executive teams running thriving businesses. And that characteristic is ideal for an effective council member. And I look forward to your questions. Thank you for your support.
Hi, thank you to the James Mckee Association for hosting this forum, and thanks to all of you for attending and participating. My name is Taki Mamalakos. I have lived in Yellow Springs for over 10 years now. I currently teach economics at Wright State University. Prior to starting work at Wright State, I worked as an energy analyst at a nonprofit. In terms of community service, the service that I've done in Yellow Springs mainly is that I'm on the board of the Yellow Springs Credit Union. I want to say a few things in terms of answering the question that was posed earlier today. I'm going to echo a lot of the ideas that were already said here. The two main issues that I see in the community are affordability and diversity. I see these issues as related. When we talk about affordability, however, too often we focus on the cost side of the equation, but we also have to focus on the income or the demand side. Wages are important. For more than a century, wages were increasing in this country. Year after year, we experienced wage gains. There was an economic foundation to the idea of American exceptionalism, yet this reality has changed. We now have the highest level of inequality in the country since the Great Depression, and wages have been stagnating since the 1970s. We have to start a conversation on this issue and try to find local solutions to this problem. A living wage ordinance I would propose and advocate if I were a member of council is one step in the right direction as far as this issue is concerned. A living wage ordinance is not a local minimum wage. Instead, it is a wage requirement for village employees, subcontractors, and any entity being given economic development assistance. The other aspect of affordability is the cost side of the equation. The overwhelming focus here has rightly been on affordable housing. Council has taken some productive steps to deal with the issue of affordable housing. The zoning code has been changed most recently to accommodate the idea of pocket neighborhoods. Some symbolic support is given to Home Inc., and they have commissioned a housing needs assessment. But I think these steps are not enough. We need more action to get more Section 8 housing in the village and more affordable rental units. Development of the glass farm, I agree, is one possible solution. If we can deal with this issue of affordability, we could go a long way in dealing with the issue of diversity. It would help socioeconomic, racial, and intergenerational diversity. The last point I want to make is that another important factor in dealing with the diversity question is maintaining a democratically accountable police force. This would send a clear message that Yellow Springs does not tolerate racial profiling, targeting of immigrants, people of color, and the working class community. We should not forget, even though it's uncomfortable to mention, that even in recent memory, the police do not have the greatest track record. Just remember the gunfight on North High Street and the New Year's Eve fiasco as two good examples of this. Now, I don't want to overstate the point. The current police chief has taken some productive steps to deal with this problem, and I support most of what the Justice System Task Force has presented as recommendations to council. One additional policy which I feel like we should implement is to cut the police budget. Right now, the police take nearly half of our general fund, and this is too much for a small community like ours. We should all be proud of living in Yellow Springs and aspire to make the village a radical model for other communities. Thank you for your attention, and if anyone wants them, there are yard signs in the back.
Good evening. I'm Kevin Stokes. First of all, I do want to thank the James A. Mckee Association and Karen Mckee for the work you've done in putting these events together. I want to thank my friends, family, and loved ones who have supported me personally and the campaign up to this point. I'd also like to thank my fellow candidates for coming out tonight and sharing your voices and your ideas with the rest of the community. I think as iron sharpens iron, we each should become better candidates as we learn and grow by hearing from one another. I am the Director of Information Technology. First of all, I am remiss in not thanking one very important person, Karen Gardner. You need to know, and the community needs to know, that I could not and would not do this without your love and support. Thank you for all you do. As I said, I'm the Director of Information Technology and Media Services at Antioch College. I'm also on the Board of Trustees of the Little Art Theater, a member of the 365 Project, and I am the tenor in the World House Play. Hopefully, Kathy doesn't hear that. My campaign will focus on three broad themes. That joke really threw me off. Three broad themes. Economic development and affordability, social justice and cultural competence, and one thing I think that I bring to the table that no one else can exactly the way I would is the symbiotic relationship between Antioch College and the Village of Yellow Springs. Since we were asked to focus on two main areas of concern, I will take one of those platforms, one of those pillars, the economic development and affordability, and break that apart. The village had a good year this past year, or this current year, through the new tax income with DMS Inc. Being part of the community and some land sales. The budget looks good, we're in the black. But we want to be able to sustain that growth or that posture. And I smiled when Taki mentioned the income side of the equation. And I told him earlier that I was going to refer to him because I'm sure he could talk about the economic side of things a little better than I could. But we need to increase our income tax base. And that means, first of all, that the employer needs to be here. It's all right to have good paying jobs where folks live here, but they work outside the village. But the employers need to be here. And I see my time starting to slip away. The CBE is a good thing for the village. I support that. I support the investments that the village has made in preparing the CBE for whether it's Crestville Labs or any other business that comes in. These are things that have to be done because a business is not going to come in and build its own infrastructure. So we need to show that we're serious about expanding the existing businesses in the area and attracting new businesses. I would encourage whoever becomes president of council to work closely with Chamber of Commerce to work closely to go out and market the village. I mean, we have a good thing, and I'm not sure that enough people know about it. I would work to support and advocate for smart growth technologies or smart growth strategies. You can take a look at my material or go to my website, kevinstokes-ys.com, to get more details about that. Those smart growth ideas would support business expansion, support workers through worker retraining where necessary, so that you can level the playing field for business opportunities, for other job opportunities, and continue to support our way of life. There's a distinction, however, that I'll make real quickly. There's a distinction I'll make between growth and investment. There's going to be a limit to how much growth we can do. We can certainly invest in what we have. I'm happy to have heard so many comments about revisiting the municipal broadband discussion. With respect to affordability, we absolutely need to increase the supply of affordable housing. And again, this is where I refer to Taki as the economic expert. But there's a balancing act that we need to be able to do. It's nice to have an expensive home when I want to sell my home, but I can't have that and then be overly concerned about the value of my home when my tax bill changes. So we just need to, again, have a good balance of what we're doing there. So again, it really often does come down to a simple matter of supply and demand. So as we increase the supply, increase the different types of homes, I think that will get there. I recently spent 3 hours with Home Inc. I'm a fan, and I'd like to formalize the relationship between Village Council and Home Inc. going forward. Thank you.
Said a lot of the things that I would say, so I'll just say me too to those, and the ones that I disagree with, maybe
louder.
They maybe I'll come to that.
Oh,
not
that.
No.
Not too
high. My name is David Turner. I've lived here in town for about 35 years. I was a cryptographic technician and the electronics technician in the U.S. Coast Guard, and I have a degree in electrical engineering from Ohio State. My wife graduated from Antioch, and our children graduated from Yellow Springs School, so we've been a part of the community for a long time. I coach baseball and soccer here. I've been on the board of both Annex School and YSI. I tutor math in the local schools. I was a charter member of the Yellow Springs Arts Commission, and I'm now a member of the Justice System Task Force, the 365 Project, and one of its subgroups, the Young People of Color. I'm a retired engineer. I like to solve problems, and I'm pretty good at it. I've got almost 45 years of experience working successfully in a lot of different areas and institutions. I've worked for for-profit institutions and not-for-profit institutions. I've been on the board of a female-run not-for-profit and a male-run for-profit, and I'll tell you, they're the same, pretty much. The women were a little nicer, but the management's in charge and you're not. So I've had this opportunity to work with a lot of people with a lot of different experiences, a lot of different education levels. People with high school education and children, all the way to PhD research scientists. I started a repair business here in town about 15 years ago, and I'm sure I've been in at least half the houses in Yellow Springs. I've been in many of yours. Everybody apologizes for their mess, by the way. I have somebody who I do some work for who's a hoarder and smokes and has 11 cats, so don't bother apologizing. You can't win. Consequently, I spend a lot of time in people's houses, talking to people downtown. I've been talking with a lot of people around here for a long time about a lot of things, and I will continue my business. So I have a lot of opportunity to find out what people think. Big issues, affordability and economic growth. Survey after survey, forum after forum, we all have found that people care about those things. Everybody said that one way or another. But I think we need to stop having more surveys to determine that that's what we care about and then figure out what we want to do about it and do those things, because generally it's true, but specifically I don't see us making as much progress on that. Economic development is the most powerful tool to aid in improving affordability and long-term viability of the village. It's a broad and vague term, affordability is, that's used to refer to villagers, but it also refers to the village itself. You know, the revenues for the village are down from state sources and other places. Costs go up, major industries have left town, and costs are ultimately going to go up. So the village has to deal with affordability for itself too. The jobs from the 20 plus years ago that used to be here and all across the country are not coming back, and we can't expect that to happen. So we have to court companies that want to be here and can provide some jobs, but not expect them to take care of the whole load. On the other hand, we can't just say, well, we don't like them, we only want these people. We can't do that too much. We have to accept a little bit. Somebody was complaining about how Republicans were backing Cresco, but well, we'll take their money. I take their money. They came and said, we want to give you money. We should say, thank you, we'll take it. Now, there isn't a whole lot the village, I don't believe, contrary to what a number of people have been saying, could do about affordability. Housing costs are high because houses cost a lot. The government of Yellow Springs can't change the housing prices, and it can't change the gasoline prices, and it can't change the food prices, and the medical care prices, and insurance prices. There are some things that we can do, and we should do those, but we should figure out what we can do to work with other institutions locally, like Home Aid, can do those things instead of hoping and dreaming about fixing things that are impossible to fix. A housing survey is being done to determine some housing need information. I think that's valuable. We should do an infrastructure survey as well to determine what sort of business infrastructure exists, parking, communication tools, space, location, things like that, so that we can use that and determine what kind of industries we do want here instead of complaining about the ones that we don't want, and use that information to court them, and that way we'll have a better match of the people coming to work for us, or to work here. I know how to gather and analyze information and make decisions and work with a lot of people. I'm a pragmatic idealist, and I think the best way forward is to figure out what we can do and then do that. I have literature in the back. I'm going to take an extra 30 seconds to do an ad in a way. My campaign literature you can throw away if you want, but on the other side are hints about handling the evils of front-loading washing machines and computers.
Thank you very much, David. Well worth the extra 30 seconds. Now we have several people that have questions for the candidates, and I thank you for being so involved. I have tried to separate them into categories. I'm not going to ask the same question twice if I have it, even though you might have said it a little differently. I will just try to move it forward. One of our people in the audience, Kim, I think it was, has asked that that I repeat the question for each candidate, but because we have so many, I think we'll do I'll say the question for the first three, and then I'll repeat it again for the next three that answers it. So we're gonna jump right in, and we're gonna jump right in with some of those hard issues or recurring issues, and we'll start with housing. And the first question is, and let's see, let's have, David, why don't we have you start with this one and then just pass the mic down. In the past, Home Inc. has been given support, land, and funding by our council. Please comment on how you will work for all of our citizens looking at alternative housing. Several seniors are trying to come up with options as they get older and start to downsize with higher utilities and taxes. So David, if you could start with speaking to that.
Well, the housing survey should provide us with some useful information to start with, and I'm sure that it's going to not satisfy some people and not have all the information we need, so we'll have to take a little bit more time and energy to figure out what specific information is needed, and then just use that information to match with the needs that exist.
Kevin?
Do I get to use the time that David didn't use?
No.
As I mentioned during my introduction, I recently spent 3 hours in the offices of HomeAid finding out about their programs and plans, policies, and their processes in terms of bringing people in. One thing that they're starting to do that some folks may not know about, a couple things actually, and I see a couple of HomeAid board members in the room, so wave. So one thing that they're doing is looking at apartments beyond just single family homes, but they're also looking at multi-unit structures. They're also focusing on senior living. They've got a couple of properties that they're hoping and planning to develop in the near future. So, and I think their very next project is expected to be something that'll have more of a senior facing focus, if you will. So in that, we have heard that some seniors are looking for different opportunities, or coming up with different ideas. Now I'm on Dave's time. And I'll stop. But there's a lot more going on to address those issues than I think a lot of us know about.
Thank you for the question. I think that council has certainly done a very good thing in supporting HomeAid. The downside is I think that most of the support has been mostly symbolic in the form of waiving tap fees and the like. I think a lot more could be done to support HomeAid, and HomeAid should be encouraged to provide for more senior housing. It's unfortunate that the plan for what is now the Mills Lawn, the Mills Park Hotel, pardon me, fell through the floor. I would also point out that if we were able to cut the police budget, as I proposed, we could also use that money and start a fund for affordable housing. So I think that's something we should think of very carefully.
Thank you. And Lisa, let me read the question one more time for the audience. In the past, HomeAid has been given support, land, and funding by our council. Please comment on how you'll work for all of our citizens looking at alternative housing. Several seniors are trying to come up with options as they start to downsize with higher utilities and taxes.
Thank you for repeating the question. I also think that the work that HomeAid has and is continuing to do is very important, but I don't think that there's a corner on HomeAid being the only entity that might, you know, step forward and try to promote affordable housing. I think there's opportunities for other entities to be created or for HomeAid to expand in its scope to have more time and resources to focus on multi-unit housing and on senior housing. I'm not necessarily advocating for Antioch College doing this, but I know personally we were very interested in the Antioch Village Charette and some of the ideas that came forward from the community about the different ways that multi-unit and multi-family dwellings could be constructed and made available. And I would certainly support that kind of future in Yellow Springs.
I think it's important to emphasize, and I talked about this in my introduction, that affordable housing and HomeAid is certainly one piece of the equation, but if we think about affordability in a comprehensive way, we need to look at a diverse selection of housing. Certainly the village's investments with HomeAid have been much more than symbolic. There's been a lot of infrastructure that's been built, there's been land that's been acquired to that the village owned, and Emily Seibel and others have presented on many occasions the millions of dollars we've leveraged from that support from the village. But I do want to highlight a couple other things that weren't mentioned. One of those being the recent pocket neighborhood development that's now in our zoning code. This is a really exciting opportunity to provide more housing, which will then contribute to affordability, because if we have more houses, that affects the demand. The other piece is we are supporting as a village infill. So we have, again, expanded the zoning code so that people can split their lots and build more houses that way. And of course, we have We have the other options for village land that we can build on as well.
Thank you. Good save.
I think that homing has done some really wonderful things for the community. But I also have to honestly say that in some ways I feel that homing has hindered further development of affordable housing. And I say this because when I looked into homing, and I had friends that looked into homing, most of them didn't find it affordable. It's lower income, yes, but it's not representing the people in this community who are underrepresented due to lower income. I think they do great things, but the reason I feel like they have kind of hurt the affordability issue in the community is because since everybody says, oh, we have Omic and they're working on affordability, nobody's going around and looking into how else we should work on affordability. It's like, we already have this one, we don't need another. That's my stand on that.
Thank you, Chrissy. So here's a question that's kind of in line with that. In regards to housing and other ways of looking at affordable housing, what is your stand, and we'll start with Chrissy, what is your stand on zoning to accommodate tiny houses in Yellow Springs?
I love tiny houses. I hope that when I'm an old lady, I can live in a tiny house. I love the idea of how easy it would be to keep clean, and who needs all that space when it's just you? I love tiny houses. And I think whatever the Zoning Commission can do to encourage that development is splendid. I want to live in a tiny house.
I don't think I have to add too much time. Certainly the pocket neighborhood development that's now part of our zoning code is promoting tiny houses. And I definitely think, from what I've seen, and Nancy Mellon actually shared with me a really great community that leveraged tiny houses to address some of these issues related to lack of housing stock and affordability, so I think it's great.
I think tiny houses will only be helpful if they are rented to people who need them for longer than a couple of nights to come and visit for street fair. And I think that it's complicated. And I know there's law about this, and I know there's zoning issues about this, but I'm concerned that if there is an increase in everybody building tiny houses and they're just renting them out as Airbnbs for individual revenue, that we'll continue to lose our community and we won't help at all the affordability of housing.
Thank you. Is it Taki? How do you pronounce your name?
Taki.
Taki, let me read the question one more time, and that is, what is your stand on zoning to accommodate tiny houses in Yellow Springs?
I don't think I have a particular stand on tiny houses. I think to the extent that people would like to build tiny houses, we can encourage them to build tiny houses. It's just a matter of individual preference. So that's really up to the individual developer. I don't really see upsides or downsides either way, honestly.
Well, since we talked about having, increasing the supply and offering different choices for the different types of homes that could exist in the village, the short answer is yay. I would support zoning changes, and as Brian alluded to, the pocket neighborhood development idea does support building tiny houses. Everything's not for everyone, but I'm sure there are enough people who feel the same way that Chrissy does and would love to live in a tiny house. I think there's enough folks here to support the idea. But at the end of the day, I think as long as we support a wide range of the types of homes that practically anyone would want to live in, I think we're moving in the right direction. Not to restrict one thing or another, not to push one thing or another, but to allow for the zoning laws to be flexible enough, for us to be flexible enough as Village Council, to modify zoning laws and rules to support those differences.
Well, we need an overall plan for what we're doing with housing, and it seems like tiny houses is one of the many little pieces that fit in the plan, unintended. Something else that I think is to have some sort of quantification, and a number that comes to mind is about $150,000 to build a house, say. Not terribly expensive house, but I think that's what somebody told me at some point the home Inc. price is. So if you build 100 of those, that's $15 million. Somebody's got to come up with $15 million to build 100 affordable houses. Whether that's the actual number that's off by 10% or 20%, I don't care. It's close. People got really upset when there was a thought of spending $15 million to build a school building. So it's just interesting that we can want to spend millions of dollars on one thing, but we don't want to spend those same millions of dollars on something else. And we, as a community, have to figure out how to balance out those feelings and some thoughts and come up with something logical instead of just running in the direction of something that we either hate or love.
Okay, thank you. We're going to change topics for a moment, and since we were speaking about spending, this is to all the candidates, and let's start with Lisa on this one. The village spent $72,000 on an investigation related to the police-incited New Year's Eve incident. How would you have handled getting the truth, that's in quotations, of what happened without spending so much money?
Well, first I want to say that the mic is probably on. I'll use my singer voice. First I want to say that, certainly what happened with New Year's was a really an experience that had a lot of impact on our community. And so not to take away from that, at the heart of the question, what I hear you asking about is the use of analysts and consultants to understand the root of challenges. And I've been a consultant for a long time, and I've also worked with organizations that hire consultants, and I know that there's ways to go about asking for an analysis proposal that helps can help save money by asking questions that don't lead the consultant to tell you information that you already know, but instead to try to understand things that you don't know.
Thank you.
All right. So obviously I was on council during this situation, and I would first of all say that it was very important to get an independent investigation and report to then take action and make changes that we did. But I will also say that we need to continue to do a better job at the beginning of these consulting or lawyer or whatever engagements, excuse me, to make sure that the work is directed and focused and that we control those expenses. So I understand that there was a lot of reaction and trying to act quickly to resolve to try to address some of these systemic problems that I think we've come a long way in a short time on. But certainly we need to not be reactive. We need to learn from some of these past experiences. And the village council did put down a very clear structure moving forward, which involves a questionnaire that Patty does at the beginning, or our village manager, of any of these engagements.
Well, concerned about how much money was spent on exploring the incident, and I understand how important it was to get an independent investigation. However, I do feel like the council was not very good at setting boundaries and telling the consultants exactly guidelines of what information we need. They went way, way too far into the incident. And I admire the council for actually admitting to this after the process was over. And I believe that they probably learned a lot from their experience in this area. So I just think that it's important that they be more mindful. What do we really need to know? And how much are we willing to pay for this? And I would like to see them hire consultants who are closer to our community instead of going and hiring a consultant group from Cincinnati or Dayton. Yes, that may be the best consultant group, but it's not necessarily the only one. We can hire more locally people.
And to repeat the question, the village spent $72,000 on an investigation related to the police incited New Year's Eve incident. How would you have handled getting the truth of what happened without spending so much money?
Well, I certainly agree with the spirit of that question. I think $72,000 was a lot of money to spend for a village of our size. But we also have to look at the other aspect here. And I always go back to an old slogan which says, no investigation, no right to speak. We have to clearly ascertain the facts in any particular situation. And in this case, it just had to be from an independent body. I think that the situation was so sensitive that it simply required hiring legal consultants. So I don't necessarily take any objection to that. I think something had to be done given the circumstances, and people were just responding to the circumstances in the best way they knew how.
Well, within the context of the question, which is what might one of us have done to reduce the cost, I was there that night, and I didn't learn anything new as a result of the study. So I didn't need the study to tell me what I knew. So again, with respect to the question, someone last night says we have consultants all over the place here in Yellow Springs. Certainly independence is a very key point. Independence does not necessarily mean expensive attorneys. So I think there's the range between zero and $72,000. And I think had we considered just doing something like a community forum, some sort of information gathering effort on our own, we would have at least had a body of information that we could share with someone. And I think at the end of the day, I did not learn anything new from the study. So personally, I didn't need the study to know what I knew. So not to say it's a complete waste, but I think we could have not spent that much money.
Well, I think it's really a couple of questions. One is, how would you handle consultants? And the other is, what idiot spent $72,000 figuring something out that I figured out when I wasn't even there? Watch a few videos, talk to some people. Officer Krupke screwed up, and some grown-up should have taken him in his side and said, don't do that again. And maybe a little bit more, but that's about it, I think. Responding with other things having to do with police issues would have been appropriate, but with that particular issue, it wasn't that complicated, I don't think. So I think $72,000 is way too much. You gotta handle consultants, Chrissy said it well. You gotta set some boundaries, you have to monitor and check out their progress and deal with them just like you deal with any other vendor.
Thank you. Continuing with the police questioning, the next question is, would you consider looking into reducing our police to nighttime and event only being underlined, and having county cover during the day? and using county dispatch to save $200,000 a year. Many communities of our size do not have their own police and dispatch due to high cost.
I think if you're going to make decisions like that, you have to look at the whole of the police force and all of the things that it does, not just pick dispatch and pick nighttime workers and things like that. So you would have to look at everything to be able to come up with, again, a plan that would cover all of the needs, not just pick and choose what you want to focus on. But it makes sense to consider those kinds of things.
I would echo Dave's comments in that we should, I don't think we want to be closed-minded. Actually, I saw some of the faces of the folks in the crowd when the question was asked, and I would suspect that they would say, no, I wouldn't consider it. But I think to do our due diligence, I think we could take it under consideration, but still make a decision that's going to be in the best interest of the village, which might mean keeping things as they are, making some adjustments. But I think, again, it's in the village's best interest and council's best interest to do our due diligence, which is not to totally dismiss something that might not seem palatable to us, but to give it our due diligence and come up with the best decision for all parties involved.
Well, I was advocating police budget cuts earlier, so I feel like this question has some pertinence. Certainly I do continue, as I said, I'll say this as many times as I have to, I do support cutting the police budget. I haven't thought very clearly about what specific items would make sense to cut as such. We could reduce personnel, for instance, that would be fine by me. I don't think I would go as far as to eliminate the entire police department and rely simply on McGreen County Sheriff's Office. I think there's a political calculation which has to be made there, and that is that even though I'm no friend of the police department, I do believe the Greene County Sheriff's Office would handle our policing much worse than is presently done by the Yellow Springs Police Department. So I would not advocate eliminating the police department. I would keep policing in Yellow Springs.
And Lisa, I'll read the question one more time. Would you consider looking into reducing our police to nighttime and event only, having county coverage during the day, and using county dispatch to save $200,000 a year? Many communities of our size do not have their own police and dispatch due to high cost.
I'm in support of a budget for the village that reflects the way we want our community to live together. And I would be in support of budget cuts for policing. However, I say that without a specific recommendation because I'm not on council now, and I would need to understand more thoroughly the rationale for the current budget. I am in favor, though, of local policing, of the relationships that are possible, the relationship building that can be possible. And I think there's opportunities for improvement. And I believe that the work that the task force has been doing is heading in the right direction. So I feel like I have a lot to learn, but my impression is that the policing budget could be reduced.
So I'm also a huge supporter of village policing, and I believe the guidelines that we've established in collaboration with many organizations in the community have set a standard. And I believe that the community has also been committed to creating a model justice system. So I do think we need to question that if we're talking about cutting budget, but we want to improve our mayor's court and think about restorative justice, and we want to continue to have the high level of community engagement that I think most of us in the village value, we can't have both. And I do think that all of our village departments are actively always looking at ways to cut the budget. I guess another piece of this is training. We're talking a lot about the importance of implicit bias training, de-escalation training, those sorts of things. Those have to be factored in as well. And before I was even on council, There was discussion of removing dispatch and going to Xenia, and that was very strongly opposed by the community. My sense is that's still where we're at. So we want to definitely have a local focus.
I guess I have two answers to that question. I would support cutting the police budget and maybe having fewer officers. And also, I would support buying less toys for the police officers. We have an awful lot of police cars for such a small community. But I definitely would not support in any way not continuing to keep our local police force, and particularly our local dispatch, because that was one of the first issues that got me going to council meetings when they started talking about getting rid of the local dispatch and having all the calls go through Xenia, or I think they were even talking about Bearborn or Beaver Creek. The beauty of that dispatch office would be such a missing thing in our community. Late at night, or you know, any time of the day, you're out, you've got a problem, you're downtown, somebody's hassling you, or there's an issue going on, there's always a person there in that window that you can go to for help, and I think that's important.
Thank you, Chrissy. Mckee, we'll have you start with the next question. Thank you, Ken. Ken says it's 9 o'clock. We only have 102 more questions. Several years ago, the village voted down the use of tax money to pay for elements of the CBE. The current council found a way to spend money for the infrastructure of the CBE regardless of this vote. What is your position on this, especially given that no contracts to purchase the land now owned by the village are definite? That's what it is. Couldn't read the last word, sorry. So the last, the end of that was purchase the land now owned by the village are definite.
Well, I was on the committee in addition with Chrissy, with Don Johnson, and with Christine Roberts, which put that issue to a vote on the referendum. So I do have a view about that. I think that the argument that we were making, or at least that I was making at the time, is that it was just too risky a proposition for the very implicit reasons suggested by the question. They had no firm commitments from any buyers, and yet they wanted to allocate $1 million to or more to this plot of land. And so I was opposed to that idea at the time on those grounds. In terms of the money that has currently been spent, to the best of my knowledge, the only money that has been spent to date was for an engineering study to accommodate the fact that the marijuana production facility was slated to move in there. I think that the argument, the original argument, has basically been vindicated. I think that the fact that council backed down from that was a good thing, and I think that that money is not necessarily against the referendum, but they were doing that for another reason.
Kevin, we also have additional question to you specifically regarding the CBE. Why do you think CBE is a good idea in spite of the fact that the village voting it down in a referendum was very supported? Doesn't this discount all of those voices?
So there's, and I'm gonna ask for help on this, but if I'm not mistaken, back in the day, was not the land owned by a private group at the time? So my understanding of part of that argument was not to spend public monies for a private enterprise. When it was owned by this separate entity, my understanding again of the argument was not to spend, again, public money for the private enterprise. Now that the village owns the land, it, I think, is certainly within that public entity's purview to spend public dollars to improve that land and ready that land for, if I'm not mistaken, out of the six of us, I think every one of us sent something in the neighborhood of economic development. And so, whereas we want to bring in new business, it's not going to be across the street from current cuisine. It's got to be somewhere on the edge of town. So what we're doing is trying to keep our downtown the eclectic place that it is, but expand business opportunities out there in an area that's designed for that. So that's why I think it's a good idea, because again, you got to put new businesses somewhere, and here's land that's screaming for new business. I hope I answered the question, and I'll hang around for a while for whoever asked the question. If you want to get into more detail, I have more discussion.
Thank you, Kevin. I'll repeat the original question again for you, David. Several years ago, the village voted down the use of tax money to pay for elements of the CBE. The current council found a way to spend money for the infrastructure of the CBE regardless of this vote. What is your position on this, especially given that no contracts to purchase the land now owned by the village are definite?
That's a loaded question. The recent expenditures, water over the dam, and the vote in the past is also water over the dam, except that people still feel really strongly about it. So, you know, I don't understand what the questioner wants one of us to say. You know, let's get the bastards who did it anyway, even though we voted against them. You know, I don't know. I'm reminded of Calvin and Hobbes' cartoon where Calvin is fishing and he's on the pier and he's got a big bucket and he stands up and says, "Here, fish." Of course, he doesn't get any fish. And I think there's a faction in this community who's saying, "Come on, money, come into my bucket. We want money." Not the way the universe works. We have to have something to bring the money in, and that's going to be businesses. And as Kevin said, that's a good place for it. There are other places for it, but what we have to do is figure out, you know, how to attract them and where we can put them there.
Yeah, I also see it as a more than one part question. I think for that land to be able to serve the village and contribute to the bottom line, some infrastructure had to go in, and that needs to happen. I mean, that's an expense of building. But I also hear in the question that it's a question of process and trust in the council. And so there's a question of, we asked for one thing, council, and something else happened. And, you know, how can we promise as a council that we will listen to you, and that if we make decisions that are unpopular, that you'll understand why? And I think that's really important. There are going to be decisions that aren't popular, and there are going to be decisions that everyone doesn't agree with. So I think for me, the most important thing that I can do is communicate actively about the decisions that are coming up, listen to you if you want to talk with me, and then after decisions are made, to help to communicate why they were made that way.
So I think it's really easy for the referendum to get confused. The question was pretty accurate in saying that, you know, what the referendum did say was not looking for funding for infrastructure improvements. I hope everybody knows that the extension of the utilities was done because we had a grant in place and we decided to use that money rather than lose it. The only other money that's been spent is on engineering so that Cresco can pay for a road and extending the utilities to their site. So I don't believe that that's contrary to the referendum at all, but I think what's interesting in this is you can tell that everybody, or many people, have different perspectives of what they were voting for. Some people don't want any development at all, I understand that. Some people don't want millions of dollars to be spent, taxpayer dollars, to be spent on infrastructure. And I will say, the letter of the referendum, I'm totally committed to. Every time an issue has come up of spending taxpayer money on infrastructure, I have opposed it.
Well, I thought the village was very clear. infrastructure, and I did feel concerned when I saw Village Council taking steps to go ahead anyways with the infrastructure, with infrastructure work on the property. However, when I looked into it and found out what was really going on, I did understand this engineering study. If we're to get this company to come here and build, this is actually kind of a bargain that we're putting in. But my main concern is that since the referendum, first the Village Council came to us with wanting to extend the utilities, and then the next thing they come back and they want us to do this engineering study. And so what's going to be the next thing? Are they going to like every year come back with, oh, well, we need to spend this money on the CD, we need to spend this money on it. And is it going to, in the long run, end up being $1 million anyway, but pulling out piecemeal a little bit at a time? So I have concerns about that.
Thank you. It is now 9:15. May I see by the applause if we could continue for another 15 minutes and just pull one question out of each category? Or would you like to end it now, and if I could ask the candidates to stay a little later so they can be, people can talk to you. We're going to take a question from taxes, we're going to take a question about fiber and a question about street fair, and then we'll open the candidates will be willing to stay afterwards and you can talk to them on an individual basis. Let's go to taxes. The Yellow Springs Village taxes are pretty regressive, something that council can fix. Families earning $35,000 to $40,000 per year are paying more in village taxes than many residents earning over $100,000. If elected, will you examine this issue? If your answer is not yes, please explain. Chrissy?
Well, I don't know a lot about that issue, but I can tell you that I'm a penny pincher, and I don't like seeing money wasted, and it doesn't matter if it's my money or your money or anybody else's money. So yes, I would want to explore that issue, and I would be very interested in those matters.
Yes, we have started exploring this, and I agree that we need to spend more time understanding both the structure of our income tax and property tax, and I believe that we are beginning that process in a more earnest way.
Yes.
The property tax and the income tax is, I agree with the question, it is intrinsically regressive. That's mainly because you can't, according to Ohio law, you can't make the income tax progressive, so you can't add brackets like what you do when you pay your federal taxes. You find out what your AGI is, and then you go ahead and you look in the tax booklet according to your income, and you find out how much you have to pay in taxes. You can't do that under the Ohio Revised Code with income taxes. So I think yes, it's a question we can look at, but we also have to take that into account.
Good answer. Yes, I would love to know more about the foundation of the way the tax code is currently. So quite simply, yes, I would be interested in investigating.
Yeah, clearly that's an interesting and a good idea. I was investigating that same thing and I came across what you said. Some of you know a lot more detail than I do, but basically if we can't do it, then we can't do it. I think that one way to deal with not only affordability, but maybe helping some of the police officers who want to live in town, would be to do something like that for them, pay them extra money, something like that, or and also offer some sort of sliding scale for utility payment too. So you could attack affordability from a number of fronts with a sliding scale.
Okay, thank you. And the closing question is in regards to the most recent street fair, or street fair in general. The street fair is a monetary success story that keeps growing. How can you envision ways that it can be a vehicle for supporting housing, arts, and other village needs?
I avoid the street fair, it's too busy for me. And I, it'd be nice if it were easier to walk around and not have to fight for parking places. It took us, what was it, sweetheart, about 45 minutes to get out of town when we wanted to go away. So spreading it out someplace, moving it, making it a little easier to get around, and if there's some way to suck more money out of it, that'd be great.
Quite simply, if the planning and preparation and execution of Street Fair was more of a collaborative effort, it is already, but if more entities were able to benefit from it financially, I think that would be just a real simple way to look at things.
I think the issue of Street Fair is very complicated for a one-minute response. I think that on the one hand, it is a boon to the community. The tourism sector does bring a lot of dollars into town. That's an economic reality. The downside is that it is a cost for the residents. It increases inconvenience on the days of Street Fair. And in addition, it imposes a burden on the workers who have to work during Street Fair. There's a lot more work involved with not that much more pay. So I think there's a mixed message in there about Street Fair, and I don't have the right answer to it.
I'm okay with getting a question.
Okay. I heard the question was about what the role of Street Fair has in housing and the arts. Yes.
Using the money.
So I'm not so sure about the housing piece, although I can imagine a separate event where Yellow Springs could become a host for some sort of festival focused on innovative housing, you know, or something like that. That was not a minute. As far as the arts, you know, I think one of the things Yellow Springs does need is a larger performing arts venue. I would hope that there's an opportunity maybe with the college and existing space, but I know that there's a number of performing arts organizations in Yellow Springs that if we had a larger hall, we could fill it. And I think we could become a host to arts festivals that could bring in multicultural events and achieve a lot of the goals that we have for the village. I don't know whether it's directly related to Street Fair, but I think we do have the opportunity to grow as an arts mecca in that way.
So Street Fair supports our nonprofits. They get free booths. They get to connect and engage with the community. It supports our local businesses. I think if you talk to the vast majority of business owners, they are big supporters of Street Fair. And thirdly, I know we, after every Street Fair, see emails and comments about people that love Yellow Springs and want to come here. I realize as residents, because I lived in New Orleans for 10 years, so Mardi Gras is not always my favorite thing, but that being said, it's really a way that we promote our community and all the great things that we do. The street performers have, you know, free range essentially to entertain folks, and I think a lot of community members are entertained as well. So I do think that all the things that Street Fair currently provides supports the community, and it continues to, contribute to that thriving community that I mentioned before. These kind of community development efforts are critical to growing our village.
Well, I have to say that having lived here so long, I'm still nostalgic for the way Street Fair used to be, or the sidewalk sale, we called it. But also, I still love Street Fair. I complain about it, as others do, as it's packed. But on the other hand, I see how it does benefit our community economically, and a lot of shop owners that I know, I've had conversations with them about it, and they really believe that it brings a lot more money into the community because people do come for the Street Fair.
Chrissy, they're asking, how could that money be used for housing or arts or other village needs?
Well, the nonprofits, they get free booth space, and I do kind of wonder why more of the monies brought in by Street Fair don't go to nonprofits and to help things in the community. So I guess that's There was something else I was going to say, but you threw me off. Well, anyway, it's lost. But I like Street Fair. I do think it could be better managed, and I don't see why it has to be so big. I think that limiting the booth spaces would be better.
Okay, thank you. So that concludes our candidates' night.
Oh, wait, can I say one last thing? It finally came back. One thing I do want to say about Street Fair, and I feel this is very important. I hear this over and over again from people who live in Yellow Springs, and they say, well, we don't go to Street Fair because we don't enjoy it anymore. And then people say, well, people come to Street Fair and they fall in love with Yellow Springs and they come back. If we don't show up, and the people that come here for Street Fair fall in love with the place, they're not falling in love with Yellow Springs, because we're not there. And the Street Fair is not how we are every day. So either support it or end it, I don't know what the answer is.
Thank you. I want to, by a raising of your hands, the last question, which of the candidates that are running actually own retail properties or small businesses in town? If you could just raise your hand if
rental
you do.
Rental properties.
Rental properties or small businesses. Okay, thank you. You know, with social media, there should be a way that we will talk about it, is to get the questions maybe up somehow so the candidates can respond to them, and we can direct you someplace where you can go and read the answers for a lot of the questions that did not get answered this evening. We do thank you for your participation. We ask the candidates to please hang around just a little bit to talk on a one-on-one basis. Many of them are having meets and greets around town. You can check that out in the newspaper and show up and ask your questions. And I'll turn it over to Karen, and thank you very much.